Okay, you ready? Here we go. Now, I'm gonna take you step by step through this process. Just a couple of things. Even though, and I said this before, even though I'm explaining it to you as separate events, it's all taking place at the same time. You got me? All right. So, again, the nervous system that's responsible for the activation of the digestive system is the parasympathetic nervous system. And the neurotransmitter for parasympathetic nervous system is acetylcholine. There's some hormones involved, too, that we're going to need to talk about. Gastrin. And ghrelin. Both gastrin and ghrelin are hormones that are released from specialized cells in the lining of the stomach. Right? Another hormone that we need to talk about is secretin. And CCK. CCK is cholecystokinin. All right, these will be important. So these are the hormones that are intimately involved in digestion. So, in the parasympathetic nervous system controls this. The gastrin and ghrelin lining in the stomach, secretin and CCK, they're released from, can you see that? No. They're released from the lining of the duodenum. Are you ready? Can you see that or no? Mm-hmm. Can you see it?
Yeah, what's your
last one? This one? Oh, a stomach. Lying into the stomach. All right? All right. There are several things that can stimulate your digestive tract. One of them is a drop in blood sugar. That's clear, right? A drop in blood sugar, hypothalamus, that's going to stimulate hunger, and that's going to activate the parasympathetic nervous system. The other one is gastrin. And gastrin is released from G cells, what up, G, of the stomach. And that too can stimulate the hypothalamus. And then there's another one called ghrelin. And that will stimulate the hypothalamus as well. Ghrelin is being looked at with new drugs, the weight loss drugs, by blocking ghrelin receptors in the hypothalamus. So people are really overweight. They're trying that. Yeah? All right. So let's start out in the mouth. With the drop in blood sugar, the release of gastrin from G cells, or the release of ghrelin from specialized cells in the stomach, that's going to stimulate the hypothalamus, which will then stimulate the parasympathetic nervous system to begin the process of digestion. And in the mouth, digestion begins in two ways, right? Chewing, mastication, right? Breaking up food. And then through the release of saliva. Saliva has a couple of functions. Number one, it contains an enzyme called amylase. And amylase begins the digestion of carbs. So digestion begins in the mouth, and it begins with the digestion of carbohydrate. Also, in order to taste food, in order to taste it on your tongue, you have to dissolve your food in solution. That solution dissolved. And that solution happens to be saliva. So lack of saliva will decrease your appetite because you won't be able to take taste food. That's why people, old people, geriatric population, they don't secrete as much saliva. The result is that food doesn't taste as good to them anymore. It doesn't. Plus, they ain't got no teethuses. So would you rather have a steak where you could chew or a pureed steak? Can you imagine sucking a steak through a straw? Yeah. And when people feed the elderly, they got dentures, and then you take the dentures out, and there's a meal from, like, 1974 on the top of their denture.
No, you know? The nastiest thing is when they take them out and they lift the stuff out. Oh, no. I hated that. Not one guy lasts a meal time. I'd be like, don't you dare. He's like, I'm not going to do it.
Just so you know, 80% of what you actually taste is what you smell. So anytime you have a cold, food has a kind of a bland taste to it. Fat makes food taste good. The reason it makes food taste good is fat, when you cook it, releases aromatic compounds that make it smell good, like bacon, right? Mm-mm. Everybody loves that bacon. Bacon. All right. So what are the five tastes that you can taste on your tongue? Do you remember from general? Sweet, sour, bitter, salty, and I don't know how to spell it. Umami. Umami, you daddy, you greasy, greasy, greasy. Those are the five tastes. All right. What's mumps? What's mumps? They're bumps. What are mumps? Oh, good. I'm going to write that down. We'll move on. It is a viral infection of the salivary glands. That's why the salivary glands become inflamed and they get swollen. That's why I brought it up, because the salivary glands are part of the digestive. See? I know, it's all related. See? There you go. All right. So, what do? You num, 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 num. Chew. Mm-mm. Have some, I don't know, something green. And then you swallow. How does the food move from your mouth down your esophagus? Peristaltic waves. And what's the little thing that covers the trachea so you don't aspirate? What's the flap thing? No, it's in your throat, actually. It's the epiglottis, right? And the muscular walls of the GI tract will peristaltically wave that food from the esophagus towards the stomach. Now watch. Where's the esophagus located? In the thoracic cavity, specifically the mediastinum. Where's the stomach located? In the left upper quadrant of your abdomen. What's the dome-shaped muscle that separates the thoracic cavity from the abdominal cavity? Please get this one right. The diaphragm. So there's a hole in your diaphragm, dear Liza, called the esophageal hiatus. That allows the esophagus to connect to the stomach. And in some cases, what will happen is the fundus of the stomach, the top part, will rupture through that diaphragm, and you get what's called a hiatal hernia. You've heard of this? Hiatal hernia? Good. All right. And as I explained to you before, each distinct part of the GI tract is separated by a circular band of muscle, right? So when you look at the stomach, the circular band of muscle that separates the esophagus from the stomach is called what? Come on, guys. What kind of sphincter? It's called the lower esophageal sphincter muscle. This is the muscle that weakens in response to GERD. So People get GERD who smoke, drink, swear, don't read the textbook, and they eat late at night. So, most of the day we are upright, right? And all the stomach contents are in the lower portion of the stomach, in the pyloric canal, that region. Hypochlorite acid, I'll explain in a minute. When you lay down, all of that stomach contents will come to the top part of the stomach. And one of the things that's digested in your stomach, and we learn this, is protein. And muscle is made out of protein. So that little muscle, that lower esophageal sphincter muscle, will be degraded by the enzymes and the hydrochloric acid in the stomach, weaken it, and will allow the stomach contents to reflux into the esophagus. So what do? Nope, you tell people not to eat late, smoke, drink, swear, and read the textbook. And then they'll tell you to actually elevate the head of the bed if you have that, so that that doesn't happen. Say yeah. Okay. We learned this in anatomy, so I'm going to go over a very rapidly. The top part of any hollow muscular organ is called the fundus. So the stomach walls themselves are made of muscle. But the inner lining of the stomach, called the gastric mucosa, say yeah, has three specialized cells in them. So in response to parasympathetic stimulation and the hormone gastrin, gastrin will stimulate one type of cell called goblet cells. And goblet cells will begin to secrete mucus. That mucus is important because that mucus will coat the inside of your stomach. And that mucus is rich in bicarbonate, that acid-base stuff. And what do acids and bases do? They neutralize each other. So this rich bicarbonate that's in that protective mucus lining can neutralize some of the hydrochloric acid that's formed in the stomach. Are you with me so far? All right, can I just show you this? I explained to you this before. What's the compound involved in inflammation? Starts with a P. And an R. Prostaglandins. Prostaglandins stimulate goblet cells to release that protective mucus lining. What does ibuprofen, naproxen, aspirin do? It inhibits the synthesis of prostaglandins. So just so you know, the drugs, the non-steroidal anti-inflammatories that you take for inflammation, it is not the drug in the stomach, but rather the effect of the drug that causes stomach problems. I had a guy, his name was Larry La Revere. He was the fire chief for the Lincolnwood Fire Department in Illinois. He looked like a Larry La Revere. He was like about 6'3". Guy was like close to 6 years old, just rock solid, right? Just a stud, right? And it was always, he never said, hey, Tim. It's like, hey, you know, effing Tim. You know how guys are when they talk. Anyways, he comes in for his physical. I go, Larry, you don't look so good. You look pale. And, of course, he flips me off and, you know, does his physical. Anyways, I drew his blood. I get the blood results the next day, and he is severely anemic. I mean, really. Like, his hemoglobin is like 8. The guy looked pale. And I go, dude, you're bleeding somewhere. I go, do you take any ibuprofen or anything? And he goes, Tim, I take those like Tic Tacs. Because his side job was to pound for sale signs into people's front yards. That was his side job. So, of course, the guy's 60 years old, he's going to have arthritis, so he was eating that all the time. He goes, I'm going on my 25th wedding anniversary. I ain't got time for this. They had to flight for life him off his cruise ship because he was bleeding so bad. He almost died. And that's because he was taking all those ibuprofen. So, see how that works. Isn't that good information?
Did you have to take them for like a prolonged
period? Yes, typically, or megadoses of those. Right? You're talking about people who take this, you know, they take 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 12 of these things a day. That's why they always tell you to eat something before you take it. Do you know why? Because I just explained it to you. the act of eating will stimulate the goblet cells to release the mucus. We have no idea how good that information is. What's that? See? Here we go. You got me? All right. Your next cells are your parietal cells. I want this whole thing. Whole thing. What do I want? The whole thing. I get the whole thing. Here we go. Guess what's coming at you? I'll give you a preview. The equation you love to hate is coming at you right now. Again, it's going to rear its ugly head. Don't you see how important that equation is? Do you? Student texted me, former student. She barely got by. She's a smart girl, but she's kind of lazy. Tim, I need help with pharmacology. I said, well, go find some. That ain't mean. Well, where is it? You know what? I'll explain it. All right. Gastrin will stimulate parietal cells. And parietal cells secrete hydrochloric acid. Want this whole thing. What's another name for a hydrogen ion? It's called a proton. Hydrogen ions are protons. This is a proton pump. These guys right here are chloride channels. You with me? Ready? Watch. Watch. Here's the parietal cell that make up the lining of the stomach. Here's your blood. So this is the lumen of the stomach. This is the opening of the stomach. This is where the food is. Are you with me? Watch. Carbon dioxide from the blood diffuses down its concentration gradient into a parietal cell. Carbon dioxide will combine with water, and in the presence of carbonic anhydrase, it forms carbonic acid. Ow, ow, ow. You with me? Carbonic acid dissociates into bicarbonate and hydrogen ions. Are you with me? The bicarbonate diffuses from the parietal cell into the blood. And to maintain the law of electroneutrality, chloride from the blood goes through a chloride channel into the parietal cell. It doesn't stay long. It says, yo, how you doing? And it immediately leaves through the lumen side through another chloride channel. And you end up with chloride in your stomach. Tell me you're with me so far. Watch. The hydrogen ions that are formed then are pumped from the parietal cell into the lumen of the stomach. And potassium is pumped back in from the lumen. What do you now have in the lumen of your stomach? Hydrogen chloride or hydrochloric acid. And that causes the pH in your stomach to be very low, 1 to 2. Tell me you got that. Now, there are receptors, watch it, on your parietal cell that can stimulate the production of hydrochloric acid. One receptor is called gastrin. Boom, and when it does that, this reaction is going to speed up. You have another receptor, watch it, called histamine. You know how to spell it. And the final one, my favorite, is epinephrine. Epinephrine stimulates the production of hydrochloric acid in the stomach. That's why when you get stressed out because you haven't been reading the textbook, your stomach bothers you. Watch it. Who's watching? Watch how good this information is. Is it stressful getting cut open, Toya? Okay, good. I'm going to write that down. So when you have surgery and you have to undergo general anesthesia generally anesthetizes everything. Because it's stressful, you're going to get the release of epinephrine. What does epinephrine do to the production of hydrochloric acid in the stomach? It increases it. Tell me you got that. Watch. Your GI tract is anesthetized. So will you make any protective mucus? So that's how stress ulcers result. That's why when someone's in surgery and they come out and you're working like in a medical surgical ICU, they have an NG tube down. And your job is every couple hours is to put some Maalox or Mylanta down that NG tube to neutralize that hydrochloric acid so they don't get stress ulcers because they can't eat. Because if you eat while your GI is paralyzed, you throw up. Don't know. I don't know. Watch. How many people have heard of this drug? Zantac. Have you heard of Zantac? Zantac is an H2 receptor blocker. That's how it reduces the production of hydrochloric acid in your stomach. Tell me you got that. Watch. Have you ever heard of Nexium, Prilosec, Prevacid, Protonix? Have you heard of those? Guess what those do? They inhibit the proton pump. That's why they're called proton pump inhibitors. Say yeah, next, you've heard of these? Tell me you got that. That is how you form hydrochloric acid in your stomach. Now watch. The bull crap about tryptophan, all that's all baloney. The reason you get tired and sleepy after you eat a big meal is you get increased parasympathetic stimulation to your GI tract the more food you eat. And that controls rest and digest. Like that, huh? There you have it. The final cell in the lining of your stomach is called a chief cell. And chief cells release the inactive enzyme pepsinogen. Remember, anything with gen after it is inactive, right? And this is one time, well, there's several examples, but this is a good example of an enzyme working at a pH optimally other than 7.35 to 7.45. What's the pH of your stomach? 1 to 2. Very, very acidic, right? So when chief cells are stimulated by gastrin to release the pepsinogen into the lumen of the stomach, it is then activated by the low pH into the active enzyme pepsin. And pepsin begins to further digest protein. So the primary nutrient digested in the stomach is protein through the very low pH, which will denature protein, and then pepsin, which will break those peptide bonds. You don't absorb the protein in the stomach. You simply digest it. Say yes. You're following this. All right? So if you ever look at the active ingredients in meat tenderizer, it's pepsin. So if you don't have any, you know, meat tenderizer, just throw up on your steak. What are you doing? I'm tenderizing it. All right. And that's why typically women, guys now, but typically women, when they suffer from bulimia, they'll eat and then they'll throw up their food, but they're also throwing up their hydrochloric acid. And their teeth will get mottled. The enamel on their teeth will begin to erode from that hydrochloric acid. So yeah, you don't want that. All right. Now, this partially digested food and the primary nutrient that's digested in the stomach is protein, right? Along with the gastric secretions, hydrochloric acid, the protein, this partially digested food is now called chyme. And this chyme is acidic. Very important that you get that. And depending on what you ate, fat makes food stay in your stomach longer. So the more the fat that's in your diet, the longer it will stay in your stomach. And your stomach have these nerves called baroreceptors. And baroreceptors, they respond to pressure. So as you eat food, the pressure inside your stomach is going to go up, and that's going to send a signal to your brain saying that you are full. People who are overweight, what happens is that their stomach in its emptied form is stretched out more than someone who is not overweight. So in order for them to feel full, they have to take in more food. Tell me you got that. They also have high levels of ghrelin, which stimulate appetite. So that's how those ghrelin blockers are gonna be trying to work on those. Yeah? All right. Do you know how they do gastric bypass? Do you wanna know? Do you? They bypass the gastric. Are you writing that down? Basically what they do is they leave a little piece of the pyloric canal, push the stomach out of the way, and connect the esophagus to that little pouch. So now you have just a little pouch of food. So in the beginning, they can eat tablespoons full of food and then they'll feel full. But over time, they can stretch out that little pouch, and they can gain that weight back. That's how it works. Gastric banding, same idea. You put the band around the stomach, so it won't allow it to expand, so the barrel receptors are stimulated much sooner. And then when you reach your goal weight, they just remove that thing, yank it out. You got me? All right. Watch. Also, found almost exclusively in the stomach, a little bit in the duodenum, there is a chemical called intrinsic factor. Intrinsic factor is required in order to absorb vitamin B12. Without intrinsic factor, you can't protect vitamin B12 from being broken apart, so it ends up useless. So intrinsic factor kind of coats the vitamin B12 and allows it to be absorbed into the blood. And without vitamin B12 and without intrinsic factor, you get a special kind of anemia called pernicious anemia. Have you heard of this? Basically, what these people do is they make really big, big, fragile red blood cells. So they're so big, it's called megaloblastic anemia, that when they go through the capillary, they will actually rupture and destroy them. That's how they get the anemia. So that's why grandpa and grandma will call you up and say, hey, can you take me to the doctor so I can get my B12 shot? So once a month they get a B12 shot because you're going around the GI tract. You are giving it to them around the GI tract. Say, yeah, got that. All right. I'm not going to go over the, I'm just going to say the anatomy. You should know this from general. Fundus, lesser curvature, greater curvature, right? The body of the stomach. And then as it narrows, this is the pyloric canal. The pyloric canal is separated from the duodenum by a circular band of muscle called the pyloric sphincter. So depending on what you ate, about 2 to 4 hours later, that stomach will begin to contract rhythmically from the fundus down, and it will push that acidic chyme into the pyloric canal. And as the pressure begins to build up in the pyloric canal, it's going to cause that pyloric sphincter muscle to relax, and you're going to squirt a little bit of that acidic chyme into the duodenum. Are you with me? In some kids, that pyloric canal, the muscles hypertrophied, and they have a hard time getting that pyloric sphincter muscle open. So when they burp up, they don't burp up, they projectile vomit. So anytime your kid projectile vomits, that's bad for you. That's pathologic. Do you projectile vomit, Jenna? Okay, good. You should write that down. No projectile vomiting today. Well, it's noon, so day ain't over yet. You never know. All right. One more thing of clinical import to you, potentially, is they used to believe that bacteria could not survive in an acidic environment, right, with very low pH. They found that one bacteria thrives in it. It's called Helicobacter pylori, or H. pylori. Have you ever heard of it? H. pylori? Yeah. H. pylori thrives in a bacterial or a very acidic environment, and the bacteria itself releases toxins that will cause the stomach lining to become damaged. So this bacteria causes gastritis. And basically what they do is, to combat that, is they raise the pH of the stomach so the bacteria can't grow as well, and then they give you antibiotics. You may be seeing this if you work in a nursing home or a hospital. A PrevPak, it's a Prevacet, a proton pump inhibitor, and then a combination of two antibiotics, usually Biaxin or Flagyl, or Biaxin and Amoxicillin. Did you ever hear of it? PrevPak did today. So if you've had gastritis for longer than 6 months, what they'll usually do is they will do an endoscope on you, and they will get a biopsy of the lining of the stomach and then test for H. pylori, or they can actually draw blood on you and see if you have the antibodies to the bacteria. If you've never been exposed to it, then you won't have antibodies built up. Okay. So yeah, got that. All right. That acidic chyme is now going to enter the duodenum. The small intestines is where the rubber meets the road. What are the divisions of the small intestines? What is it? Nice. Duodenum, jejunum, ileum. And the first part is the duodenum. Now look. This is where the rubber meets the road here. Right? Now watch. I'm going to explain to you the trinity here, the three big accessory organs of digestion. Right? Listen up. I'm going to explain these to you, and then I'm going to put it together for you. Are you with me? The liver has tons of functions. Its primary function in digestion is twofold. Big functions. Number one is that it filters, detoxifies, and stores stuff that you have eaten, right? This is really important. Everything that you put into your pie hole has to go through the liver on the way in. It also goes through the liver on the way out. The liver has a portal circulation, two capillary beds, not going through the heart, meeting. You got me? So if you look here, where is it? All the veins of your GI tract meet at the hepatic portal vein. So everything that's digested and absorbed from your GI tract goes through the veins and meets at the hepatic portal vein. Once you go through digestion and absorption, and if the liver filters it, that blood leaves the liver through the hepatic vein. So the hepatic vein then takes the blood that was filtered by the liver and then dumps it into the central circulation. So the liver has a pretty healthy lymphatic supply too, so it can destroy anything harmful. And it also has enzymes called, I wish I could spell, cytochromes. These are a series of enzymes that detoxify drugs and alcohol. You got me? Watch. Alcohol. You drink it, it gets absorbed into the blood, and then it goes to the liver through the hepatic portal vein, and then that alcohol gets broken down. So you have alcohol, and then that series of cytochromes, they will act on it and break the alcohol down to aldehydes. And then the aldehydes are broken down to CO2 and water. The extra aldehydes, right, if you're not metabolizing these things, they get converted to fat and stored in your liver. That's why boozers can get a condition called fatty liver. Have you ever heard of that? And fatty liver, basically what it does is it strangulates your liver. The fat deposits build up, and it actually strangulates your liver. Now watch. There is a drug called antabuse. Have you ever heard of antabuse? Have you? You've heard of it? Antabuse is a drug that they give alcoholics, and it affects this little pathway. It prevents the aldehydes from being broken down to CO2 and water, right? By inhibiting the hormone or enzyme called alcohol dehydrogenase. So aldehydes, formaldehyde, these people get pickled. When aldehydes build up in your blood, they make you sick. They stimulate the medulla, which is involved in vomiting, and you throw up. Also, aldehydes are massive arterial vasodilators. That's why you have some people who are called flushers. They drink and they turn red. You ever see those people? Asians are notorious for being flushers. So I went to Beijing. I was doing a research study, a clinical trial. So we were in Beijing, and these Chinese counterparts, when you go there, you whatever you want to do, they will do, no matter what. You jump out of an airplane, okay, I'm going to jump out of an airplane. So, of course, I'm drinking, so they're drinking. And the next thing I know, like 15 minutes later, they were like bright red. I'm not even kidding. I thought, you can just turn off that light and they will glow in the dark, little Chinese glow lights. I'm not even kidding. And you could tell they weren't feeling so good, so I like just stopped and I started drinking coffee because I didn't want them to die on me. But that's why you flush. Tell me you got that. What's that? Who'd you hear that from? Yeah, there's a lot of truth in that. It's the only cell that can regenerate itself. Its DNA is not locked in the G0 phase, meaning that those cells can divide and replicate themselves. So, but if you damage about 70% of your liver, it is over for you. You'll need a liver transplant. That's why people can have cirrhosis of the liver. They can be jaundiced, but if they haven't destroyed 70% of their liver and you cut off why they're damaging their liver, that liver will regenerate itself. That's why you can donate part of your liver. And what's interesting about that is that you, like if you have a kid, like a baby, say they're 5 years old and they go into liver failure for whatever reason, if you donate a part of your liver, the liver will regenerate, but it will only grow to accommodate the body cavity that it's in. So it will grow to the exact size of that baby's liver that they need. So absolutely you can.
Is that because it has all this stuff stored?
No, not necessarily. It's just more with the DNA that they have the ability to, they're not locked in G0. And they divide rapidly. That's why liver cancer, if you get spots on your liver and they think it's cancer, from the time that you're diagnosed till the time you're taking a 6-foot dirt nap, it's about 6 months. It's very, very, very rapid. And also the liver has a huge lymphatic supply, but the best way to spread cancer is through the lymphatic system. Tell me you followed that. Got that, guys? Yes or no? You do? All right. So watch. Can I just show you this real quick since we're on the liver? You notice how I put this in yellow? What's that look for, Rebecca? Do you know why I put it in yellow? For real? Well, do me a favor. Leave so I can tell everybody and then come back and then you can continue to wonder. Ready? Watch. All of the blood from your GI tract goes to the liver through the hepatic portal vein on the way in. And I'm just going to tell you this. Veins have no pressure, so they are thin, muscular walled. You got me? So when you digest food, and that blood with all of your digested food is going back to the liver through the hepatic portal vein, if the liver is damaged, then that blood cannot all be handled by the liver. So that blood will begin to back up in the liver, and it will begin to back up into your GI tract. And because those veins are weak-walled, they will balloon out. So anyone who drinks booze on a regular have got hemorrhoids. Hemorrhoids are weakening of the walls of the GI tract in the rectum. Tell me you got that. Are you following? That will never come back and haunt you. Ever. So watch. That's what the liver does. Detoxifies, stores. Yep. The other thing that it does is it makes blood clotting factors. So watch. Remember, when an organ fails, all the functions of that organ fail. So what ain't they gonna be able to make? They ain't gonna be able to make clotting factors. So when they bleed, will they be able to stop their bleeding? That's why people in liver failure bleed to death. Isn't that good? No? Okay. Do you want to hear a story about Barry McAllister? Do you want to hear that or no? You do? Who wants to not hear it? Just give me one person so I don't have to tell you. Rebecca doesn't. No, you don't? Okay. Makes blood clotting factors. The other thing it does is that it stores fat-soluble vitamins. So, and that's D, E, A, and K. Those are the fat-soluble vitamins. And remember, boozing is rough on your stomach. So they will lose intrinsic factors. So many alcoholics have pernicious anemia as well. Have you ever seen a banana bag? Do you know what a banana bag is? It's a bag full of bananas. That's what, right? Banana bag. A banana bag is usually given to alcoholics because what do alcoholics eat? I'll just tell you. They eat alcohol. And alcohol has very little vitamins or minerals in it. So these guys are vitamin depleted and they can't store any fat-soluble vitamins, right? So they give them a banana bag intravenously to bypass the liver. The yellow in it is thiamine. That's what gives it its banana or yellow color. Huh? Wasn't that good? No. What? What was I supposed to tell you? Oh, do you want to hear that story real quick? You can update your Facebook status, Rebecca. Watch. This is about like 8-10 years ago. It was a week right before the 4th of July. So when I go there on Friday, I don't have to clock in. So the big warehouse door was open, and I just walked in, right? And I see Barry. He was in head of charge of the warehouse. He goes, "Hey, Tim, can I talk to you?" I'm like, "Sure." He goes, "Look, I got these blood blisters, and I poke them, blood squirts out, and then I can't get it to stop bleeding." So I looked at him and I said, "What do you want from me?" And I went and did my job. That was the story. So watch how smart I am. He was a boozer, right? Barry never met a beer he wouldn't drink. So, and also back in his early days, he was a heroin addict. You got me? So I said, let me check your liver. Because I know, because I study this stuff, the liver produces blood clotting factors. And when an organ fails, all the functions of that organ fail, including making blood clotting factors. Couldn't clot. Tell me you got that. Now watch. Watch how I'm going to bring this all home for you. All of it. What does a liver do? What does a liver cell do? Liver stuff. So watch. Here's a blood. There's a liver cell. You got me? And there are specific liver enzymes in there. I'm not going to get into detail. You can learn something in clinical. You're going to learn a lot. Those are your liver enzymes. Say, yeah. If your liver's healthy, where should those liver enzymes be? That's right, in your liver cell. But if you're a boozer and don't read the textbook, the cell membrane ruptures and those liver enzymes go into the blood. Say, yeah. Do you see this? You want me to just stop? Watch. So his liver enzymes, if you have liver enzymes that are elevated, normal's maybe 30 or 40, and yours is 48 or 55, if you look on the internet, you have liver cancer and you have 3 weeks to live. But because people don't understand this stuff, and I do because I have degrees, these liver enzymes go into the blood, and when you have values that are elevated 4, 5, 6, 7 times normal, now you have a problem. Because as you just heard me say, the liver can regenerate itself. So you are not even giving it time to regenerate, and you are destroying it. Say yes. So I thought he had lymphoma, to be perfectly honest, based on his other labs. Anyways, this is not the kind of information that you give someone over the phone. So on a Monday, that Monday, I drove down there, and I said, do you have a doctor? And he goes, do I need one? I said, you needed one yesterday. So I got him hooked up with the VA because he was a vet, and not only did he have liver damage from boozing, but he also had hepatitis C from his heroin days. And they got him on interferon, and he was straight. He did okay. Now, if I would have said, what do you want from me? Put a Band-Aid on it. I got people to see. He would have been dead. And I told him, I said, look, and this is the important part of the story. I said, you take one more drink, and it could be your last. And I'm not even joking about that. And he goes, I just bought a 30-pack Old Style for the 4th of July. And I go, my liver works. So he didn't have a car, and he only lived about 4 blocks away. So he got done at 2:30. And I left early that day, and I dropped him off, and I picked up that 30-pack. I was saving him from himself. And I drank. That's the good part of the story. No, it's almost simultaneous that all these things just start going bad at the same time. And again, it's the degree of liver damage. Again, if you go out and booze it once a week, you're not going to end up with liver failure because you booze it once a week, right? Yeah, I'm talking about heavy-duty boozing every single day. That's what's going to do it. Or not reading a textbook. I've had many students that were here 5, 6 years ago that are now waiting liver transplants because they didn't read the textbook. Look, you want to be that way? That's completely up to you. I mean, hey. Tell me if you followed that a little bit.
Yeah, I
I wish you really did. I do, because that's good. Yeah. Okay. That's Barry's story. Just so you know, he died of a heart attack about 4 years ago. He was 66. He was just about to retire. And then watch how no good deed shall go unpunished. He got hurt on the job, right? And this is years back. I told him, Barry, if you need anything, just call me up, and if I can help you, I will. So he calls me up in January. He says, Tim, my workers' comp doesn't kick in for a month, and I can't pay my rent. I go, how much you need? He goes, $1,500. I said, come in on Friday, and I'll give it to you. And then 3 weeks later, he dies of a heart attack. You know what I told him? I said, all I want is the TaylorMade R11 driver left-handed. That's all I want. If you get me that and you bring it in here for me, I don't care how much you pay for it. I don't care if you steal it. Then we are good. And here's why. I could not go to a sporting goods store, look at a golf club that costs $500 and pay that much. I couldn't do that. So I didn't get my money back or a driver. Why are you giving me that look? That's a sad story. So 3 years ago, after I got done cutting my mom's grass, I'm like, I'm going. I'm talking myself into it all the time, and I'm going. So as soon as I got done, I go, Ma, I'll be back. And I went to Dick's right over there, 31. And I looked at it, I'm like, $500 for a driver. Then I saw the older model for $149, and I bought that. That's crazy. Some people, like my human turd for a nephew, he has no problem spending money he doesn't have on himself. I go, did it ever occur to you that maybe your kid will need something? Well, Michelle's got that. Losers have the most fun in life. Write that down. If you're a loser, what do you worry about? Nothing. Your next good time. Right? And you know what? Being not bright is not such a bad thing. Like, if you're stupid, that's not a bad thing. Because, like, you really don't know that you're supposed to try to achieve something in life, so you just go, oh, okay, whatever. Right? The worst thing in the world is to have a little talent and a little drive. That makes your life very difficult. If you're extremely talented, life is easy. Right? If you're a loser, life is easy. Right? But we're all in it together. Say yeah. Got me? Here we go. Liver. Manufactures cholesterol, too. Don't we know that? Don't we know that? Rebecca? Don't we know that? Makes albumin. Without albumin, you get a big belly. You got me? And it makes bile. The liver, this is its primary function in digestion. Well, the filtering's huge, detoxification. But do we know where bile comes from? Do I have to explain that again? Or do we? Do you know where it comes from? Do I have to explain it? Yes or no? Huh? Jenna, do you know where bile comes from? No, there's no notes. For real? Well, I better explain it to you so you know it offhand. Ready? How long do red blood cells live? Protein, I'll just tell you. Hemoglobin. Embedded in the hemoglobin is iron. We know there's four, but I'm not going to waste your time. I'm only putting one. When a red blood cell dies, it can go to the spleen, the liver, or the rectplex, the reticuloendothelial complex, which is basically a series of enzymes that line blood vessels. So the red blood cell membrane becomes broken down, and it reveals the hemoglobin. Then enzymes attack it and break it down to heme and globin. The globin is amino acids chemically bonded together. So those are broken down in the liver, and they are either converted to glucose or fat through a process of gluconeogenesis or lipogenesis. Oh, taking stuff that ain't glucose and converting it into glucose. Like that. The heme portion is different. The heme is then broken down to bilirubin and then iron. Free-floating iron in your blood is bad for you. Do you want that in your, you want free-floating blood, a lot of it? Uh-uh. No way. That's bad. You ever hear of a condition called hemochromatosis, Toya? Everybody. Hemochromatosis, XBLN. Okay. Hemochromatosis is excessive iron stored in the liver. Leads to heart disease, cancer. Guys, because women bleed once a month, you should write that down. Excessive iron stored in the liver and blood. So where do you get, where's the vast majority of your iron? In a red blood cell. So people with hemochromatosis are told to donate blood once a month to lower that iron. All right? So watch. The heme is then broken down to bilirubin. And bilirubin has a yellow color. If you've ever gotten a bruise, you got me? Initially it turns red, right? But then as that blood is broken down, the red blood cells are broken down, and it'll turn like a yellowish green, right? And then finally go away. And that's due to the destruction of those red blood cells and the formation of bilirubin. Are you with me, guys? Okay, here we go. So that bilirubin then gets transported to the liver. What color is bilirubin? Yellow. So that's very bronchitic. That bilirubin then gets converted to bile in the liver. So again, when a organ fails, all the functions of that organ fail. So if your liver takes bilirubin and converts it to bile, are red blood cells still dying all day? So you will make bilirubin, but the bilirubin will not be able to be converted to bile as rapidly because the liver is failing. So that bilirubin will back up in the liver, back up in the blood, and back up into the tissues, and you get jaundice. If you're jaundiced, that's a late sign of liver failure, right? You see somebody who's yellow, you better get right with them. Because they're going to be on their way out. All right, watch. Bile is made in the liver. Bile is made of bilirubin, bile salts, and cholesterol. Cholesterol that builds up in your arteries causes the plaque hardening. So excessive cholesterol buildup in bile can lead to the formation of gallstones. Are you with me here, guys? All right, just watch. What's that? That's triglyceride. That's how it is in your GI tract, right? So here's your GI tract. Right? Whoops. Then you have cells of small intestines. You got me? And you don't know this yet, but I'm going to tell you. Fat and cholesterol, when they're digested, are not absorbed into the bloodstream. They're absorbed into a lacteal, which is part of the lymphatic system. Are you with me, guys? Remember this. Just remember this. You with me? All right. So when we get there, I'm going to explain to you how you digest and absorb fat. Now watch. In order to successfully digest fat, you have to emulsify it. Basically, what bile does, bile is the emulsifier. And if you take bile, which is basically, it's a big fat droplet, right? And what you will do is that little fat droplet will break down the fat into free fatty acids and monoglycerides. Are you with me? So watch. You have triglyceride. This little bile inside that little fat droplet, there are enzymes. Go figure. And it will break it down into free fatty acids and a monoglyceride. It was triglyceride. Now there's only one fatty acid hanging off it. So that's mono. That's Spanish for one. Are you writing that down? And that gets attached to this fat droplet of bile. This fat droplet of bile, along with the free fatty acids and monoglyceride, is called a micelle. Are you with me? The function of this micelle or this bile is to allow fat and cholesterol to get into the cells that line that make the lining of the small intestine. You got me? Once they're transported, and the little bile, it's not transported. All it does is move the monoglyceride and these free fatty acids to the cell membrane of the small intestines. Then they get dumped into the cells of the small intestine. So you have monoglyceride and free fatty acids. And they are repackaged into triglyceride. And then they get a big freaking ride. They ride on a big freaking protein. And that big freaking protein, so big, it's called a big freaking protein, is called a chylomicron. So basically think of a chylomicron as a big bus that's picking up fat and cholesterol. Where do you need it to go? You need it to get into your bloodstream. But watch. This fat and cholesterol in this chylomicron is so freaking big, it can't get into the bloodstream. So it gets into the lacteal, which is part of your lymphatic system. And you better know this. We learned this. I'll never forget it. I think it was a Tuesday. All lymph vessels dump their lymph where? The right side of the heart. So all these chylomicrons that were absorbed from the cells into this lymph vessel, they will get dumped slowly over time into the right side of the heart. Tell me you got that. Now watch. This is why, because this process is so slow, that it takes about 8 to 10 hours for anything that you ate that has fat and cholesterol in it to show up in your bloodstream. That's why if a doctor wants you to fast, they're checking you for triglycerides and cholesterol in your blood. Because if you're not fasted, anything that you ate prior to that can show up in your bloodstream. Tell me you got, that's why you do that. If you're not a diabetic, your blood sugar's back to normal in about 3 hours. So you shouldn't have to fast that long for blood sugar. But they're going to be looking at your lipid profile. Tell me you got that. Now, there's a drug out there called Allied. Have you ever heard of it? Well, I don't know what it is. Is it Allied? Anyways, what it does is it prevents bile from breaking down those triglycerides. It basically binds with bile so bile can't do its job. The result is that if you can't break up the triglyceride into free fatty acids and a monoglyceride, you can't absorb it into the bloodstream. And if you can't absorb it into your bloodstream, can you use that to get fat? No. The problem with that is that you'll start digesting this fat in the large intestines, or if you don't digest it, you get what's called fatty poop, and it stinks. It's just awful. I was doing a research study. I was working with this doctor, and he was taking that. And that freaking guy would come in every morning and just louse up the patient's bathroom. So after the third time of doing it, I'm like, what are you doing, man? I said, we got people coming in before work, after work. They're not getting any money to be in this study, and you're crapping in the bathroom, and it stinks. Go stop at an Amoco station. Can you believe that? But that's how they lose weight. It's called a bile acid sequestrant. Bile's important. Say, yeah. And then the bile, when it gets into the large intestines, it's reabsorbed back into the large intestines so it can be recycled. Tell me you got that. Did you follow that at all? Okay. All right. Watch. Where's bile made? Where's bile stored? What is the definition of a bladder? Come on. It's a hollow muscular organ, right? So what does the gallbladder do? I'll just tell you. It contracts and relaxes because it's made of muscle. Watch, you make the bile in the liver, it then leaves the liver and gets stored in the gallbladder. The gallbladder does really two things. It stores the bile, but it also dehydrates it, so it removes the water from the bile. So the bile that you have in the gallbladder is much more concentrated. The gallbladder, just like the stomach, have rugae. Right, the little folds that allow the gallbladder to expand and contract based on the amount of bile that's present. Are you with me, guys? Okay. Now, what else is in bile? Cholesterol. So when you remove the water, the cholesterol and the bile salts can make that bile thick and sludgy. So you can actually get a condition called bile sludge, right? Or you can start producing stones. So people can end up getting stones in their gallbladder. Now watch. This is where knowing a little anatomy could really help you out if you'd only remember this. I wish I knew what I could do to make you remember this stuff. Rebecca, you got any idea? Yeah, I still don't think that would help. And what are you going to do? All right, so watch. A duct is a hollow muscular tube. The ducts of the liver, gallbladder, and pancreas also have goblet cells. They secrete mucus. That mucus helps protect the duct from any potential damage. It also helps move that stuff into where it needs to go. Are you with me, guys? Watch. You make the bile in the liver. The bile leaves through the hepatic ducts, and as you can see, the common hepatic duct and the cystic duct come together to form the common bile duct. Tell me you know this. I'm not going to look. The common bile duct comes together with the pancreatic duct to form what's called the ampulla of Vader. So what I'm trying to explain to you is that the gallbladder, pancreas, and liver all dump their contents into one common area. What that means is that if you have liver problems, that can lead to gallbladder and pancreatic problems. If you have gallbladder problems, pancreatic and liver problems. If you have pancreatic problems, it can lead to gallbladder and liver problems. Do you see that? Now, watch. You had that acidic chyme. I'm now starting the process of digestion. Are you with me? Right? We got through the stomach, right? That acidic chyme is now going to enter the duodenum. It's acidic. I'm going to write acidic. You with me? pH is low. The enzymes that are released by the pancreas, they work optimally at a pH of 5 to 6. What's the pH of this acidic chyme? 1 to 2. Tell me you got that. So when that acidic chyme enters the duodenum, specialized cells within the duodenal lining will release into the blood the hormone secretin. So if I ever see you, I'll completely ignore you, but if I happen to bump into you and have no choice but to say hi, I'll ask how you're doing, and you can say I'm secretin or pumping 5 liters, whatever you want to do. But yeah, secretin. Why was secretin released? Because there's acidic chyme in the duodenum. Are you with me? Secretin's primary function is to stimulate the cells of the pancreas. Uh-oh. Are you ready? Here we go. You're not going to believe that, but pancreatic cells have on their cell membrane, I mean, cut it out, secretin receptors. So if you look here, oops. This right here, this little picture right here, represents the pancreatic duct. Are you following me? When secretin stimulates pancreatic cells, it causes the release of bicarbonate into the pancreatic duct. What's the charge on bicarbonate? It's negative. So to maintain the law of electroneutrality, sodium follows it. And what cell follows sodium? By osmosis. So that's how you make the pancreatic juice. Like that? Tell me you got that. In addition, secretin releases specific enzymes into the pancreatic duct. It releases pancreatic amylase, which digests carbs, pancreatic lipase, which digests fat. Are you with me? Pancreatic trypsin. I wish I could spell. How do you spell that?
Trypsin.
Chymotrypsin. Whoops. You got me? Do you eat DNA? Yes. So you will have nucleases released. I'm just going to do this. You got me? Those, along with the pancreatic juice and the little duct, that little duct is going to move these things through the pancreatic duct, and they're going to get dumped into the duodenum. Are you with me? The bicarbonate is going to raise the pH of that acidic chyme, and once the pH is raised to about 5 or 6, those enzymes will now start working and digesting your hangaburger. Tell me you got that. How many people are with me? Guys? Okay, watch. What's the treatment for pancreatitis? Acute pancreatitis. You know what pancreatitis is, and don't say an inflammation of your pancreas. What is it? Were you going to say that? Good thing you didn't. Bam.
Infection.
Bam. What is it? Come on. Watch. This is going to be the best thing you ever learned in this class right here. And it's going to make perfect sense to most people. Ready? Watch. Rebecca, are you going to pay attention to this? You are? Okay. Are you taking the multiple guest final? Because I was going to say, I'm going to give you this question specifically. Yeah. Ready? Okay, watch. 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 The most common cause of acute pancreatitis is cholelithiasis and biliary obstruction. Watch. Watch. If someone develops gallstones, when they get food in their duodenum, secretin is going to stimulate the gallbladder to contract. If that stone is small enough, it will go through the cystic duct, the common bile duct, but it can get lodged in that little muscle called the sphincter of Oddi, and it will block the ability of the pancreas to dump its contents into the duodenum. You got me? So watch. If you have a gallstone blocking that little sphincter of Oddi, and that person eats, secretin's going to stimulate pancreatic cells to release these enzymes. What do they digest? Carbs, fat, protein, DNA. What are pancreatic cells made out of? So if they're not getting dumped into the duodenum, they're going to end up in the little ampulla of Vader there, and they will get turned on over time. And they will do their job, and they will digest fats, carbs, protein, and DNA, and you will begin to digest your pancreas. That's pancreatitis. Watch. What caused the pancreas to digest itself? What was that? What causes stuff to be released? Food in your duodenum. So if somebody has acute pancreatitis, do you want them eating? No. They can't eat at all. And not only that, stomach secretions, what? Can stimulate the pancreas to release enzymes. So not only do they not get to eat, but they got an NG tube stuck down them and sucking out the stomach contents. Then you give them some anti-inflammatories, antibiotics, pain medicine, and you say a prayer. Say, yeah. That's so good. God, that's good. Because watch, instead of having to make a nursing care plan and looking up all this stuff, if you just understood that, I know what to do for a person with acute pancreatitis because I know how this works. You don't think that's good? No. You remove the stone. Could be. They do what's called an ERCP, an endoscopic retrograde cholangiopancreatography. They snake an NG or an endoscope down, and then the endoscope has a camera and a little claw. You go into the sphincter of Oddi, dilate it, grab the gallstone, pull it out. There you have it. Don't you think that's cool? You could figure that out a little bit. Here, I'll go over this and I'll give you a break. How do you know your pancreas is getting jacked up? You're deaf in like 27 nations. Can't hear you. Pancreatic cells in the blood? You don't get cells in a bloodstream, they're too big. What enzymes? You will never have to know that, though. Because like in when you cover your GI series in clinical, they never talk about pancreatitis at all, ever. Never. Yeah, I saw you labs. Serum amylase, serum, oh. I know, that's really weird. I don't get that at all. Why would they do that? All right, take a break. We're going to knock this out. It's going to be beautiful. You know what? You got to don't do it, right? I've never done that stuff because I know me. I got an addictive personality, and I would get locked in. I would. Never. I've never had a narcotic in my life. Never. I'm afraid of that.
I am too.
That stuff, man, that'll mess you up. You want to end your life real quick? Do that. All right, here we go. You got the pancreas, yes?
The lining of the small intestine.
Yes, tough. Watch. When you eat a meal that's particularly high in fat, that fat doesn't get digested in the stomach. Protein gets digested in the stomach, right? So this meal that's high in fat, in order to adequately digest the fat, you have to first emulsify the fat. What emulsifies fat? And where do you store bile? That's right. So watch. When there's a meal that's high in fat, That's going to enter the duodenum, and there are specialized cells in the lining of the duodenum that release the hormone CCK, cholecystokinin. Cholecyst is the prefix for gallbladder. Kinin means kinetic movement, so it will cause the gallbladder to contract, and that will squish the bile into the duodenum to emulsify that fat. Tell me you got that, guys? All right. When that fat is emulsified, what happens is some stuff. What really happens? I don't even know. Not that. Come on. On what? Yeah. No, that was when I was in Chicago. Yeah, why? You were looking forward to go meeting some new NBA players, huh?
No, I wish she was.
I do.
You were going to be the one looking in the mirror like
this. Yeah, right? So watch. The bile emulsifies the fat, right? But the bile fat has those enzymes that will break down the triglycerides into monoglycerides, or monoglyceride and then free fatty acids. You got me? That gets absorbed into the cells of the lining of the small intestines. They're packaged back into triglyceride, and then they take a ride on a big protein called chylomicron, and then they're dumped into the lacteal, which is part of the lymphatic system. Say yes. All right. Now watch. The lining of the small intestines is located, or in the small intestines, is loaded with villi. And then on top of the villi, lining the villus, are individual cells with further extensions of the cell membrane called microvilli. So this is what allows that massive increase in surface area for digestion and absorption of nutrients. So the small intestines is where you digest and absorb the nutrients that you ate. So anything that impacts the small intestines is going to impact your ability to get nutrients into your bloodstream and ultimately your body and your cells. Tell me you got that. All right. This is really important. Unlike any other cell of the body, this is the lumen of your small intestine, right? So it looks like you had some Kellogg's sugar smacks for breakfast. Dig them. Then it's a cold winter's night in England. The snow is falling. You got me? And now what we're going to do is we're going to look. See those extensions? Those are the villus. Now watch. Watch. Oh, darn it. What's this? Second. That's it. No. Too much work. I'm busy. All right, so watch. Here we go. I want this whole thing. This is the important piece. Here's the villus, and then you have individual cells that line the villus, right? And embedded in the villus is an arterial and venous capillary, and then in the middle is that lacteal, part of the lymphatic system. You're following, guys? Yes or no? I don't care. just doing it. All right. Now we're going to take a closer look. Right, the little box. Boom. So here are the individual cells here. Now watch. Here's the lumen of the small intestine. So this is where your Kellogg's Fruity Pebbles come in. Unlike other cells of the body where they have the enzymes inside them, the small intestines, where's your food? In here. The specific enzymes are embedded in the membrane of the microvilli. So this little microvilli and the enzymes that are embedded in the small intestines make up what's called the brush border of the small intestines. So this is where the enzymes come in contact with the food that you ate. And embedded in these little microvilli are specific enzymes. There are proteases that digest protein. There are carboxylases that digest carbs. And there are lipases that digest fat. Now, if you lack a particular enzyme, then you will not be able to digest that particular type of food. So when people who are lactose intolerant, they don't have the enzymes that digest the sugar found in milk and dairy, right? So they can't digest lactose. Say yes. What's that? Yeah. You've heard of celiac disease? Celiac disease is a disease of the small intestines where it's really powerful autoimmune, where it will actually attack, your immune system attacks the enzymes in the small intestines that are involved in digesting the protein found in wheat products. So it's just not a lack of an enzyme. It actually begins to erode those cells and will cause damage. So this is a disease that's just not as simple as lacking an enzyme. It can have really, really bad effects. The immune system just kind of goes unchecked there. Are you following me? You're with me here. Guys, now this is important. Remember, and we just talked about it, and I want that whole thing, by the way, with triglycerides and cholesterol, right? They're first digested and then packaged into that micelle, right? And then brought into the cells. And then those triglycerides and cholesterol are repackaged, and then they're put on that chylomicron, right? So the triglycerides and cholesterol take a ride on the chylomicron. And because of its size, it can't be absorbed into the bloodstream. It has to be absorbed into the lymphatic system. Say yes. All right. Takes a ride on the chylomicron, and then it's absorbed into the lymphatic system. Now look. Watch. If you eat carbs, this is important. Carbs are digested by the carboxylases specific, and inside the cell membrane of the cells that make up the small intestines, there are these little co-transporters. And they will transport simple sugars and sodium at the same time. So glucose and sodium, not into the lacteal. Glucose and sodium get absorbed from your GI tract into the venous end of the villus. Are you with me? Now, this is important. One of the things that they found that carbs and sodium get reabsorbed in this co-transport mechanism is these people in Africa, you know, third world countries, they were getting dysentery and these kids were dying. So a guy figured out that if you can get them at least some carbohydrates, that they will reabsorb the sodium and what will follow from the GI tract by osmosis so they could rehydrate themselves. So this guy literally, with this little discovery, saved millions and millions of people's lives. That's why they want to make sure that you can get the sodium in there, so they'll always give you a little bit of carbohydrate to eat, even if you're diabetic. All right, so watch. You with me? All right. And then you have proteases, and they're going to digest protein, and they're going to break it down into individual amino acids or very small chained amino acids, one or two amino acids long. Thank you. Those amino acids then are brought into the venous end of the villus. Now, what's the only fuel the brain could use? Glucose. So watch. If the brain required fat or cholesterol, excuse me, fat or cholesterol to be used as energy, and your fat and cholesterol levels dropped in your blood, it would take you 8 hours to wake up. But that's why, because the brain relies on glucose as a fuel. When your blood sugar drops, you don't have to digest it. You can put it in between their cheek and gum, and it will, because it's absorbed directly into the bloodstream, it will raise their blood sugar. That's why when people pass out and they got that glucose paste in there, you put it in their cheek and gum, it's absorbed directly into the bloodstream to raise their blood sugar so they wake up. Body doing stuff that makes sense. See? Did you see that? Isn't that good? Yeah, it's wonderful. Tell me you got that. All right. So, small intestines, brush border, increased surface area, specific enzymes embedded in the microvilli. Say yeah. Fat and cholesterol broken down, packaged into a micelle, brought into the cell, re-put together, packaged in a big protein, chylomicron, dumped into the lymphatic system, dumped into the blood 8 to 10 hours later. Glucose, carbs, digested in the simple sugars, absorbed into the venous end. Protein, packed into amino acids, individual or small chains of amino acids, and they're brought directly into the bloodstream. Say yeah. All right. We're doing good. Now watch. About 70% of your lymphatic system is in the small intestines. About 80% of that 70%, and remember, 50% of the time, it works 100% of the time. Anchorman. I know that movie's so stupid, but I like it. That's why I like it. You got me? About 70% of your total lymphatic system is in your GI tract, and about 80% of that is in your small intestines. So not only do you digest and absorb those nutrients, but that stuff is purified. So the stuff that's in the small intestines is clean. You got me? It's damn near sterile. Once you've digested and absorbed what you're going to absorb in the small intestines, the remainder goes to the large intestines. The large intestines, are there digestive enzymes in the large intestines? Mm-hmm. Toya? Huh? Come on. Are there? Rebecca, digestive enzymes in the large intestines. Say no. Good. So, watch. There is a valve that separates the ileum from the first part of the large intestines. What's the first part of the large intestines called? The cecum. Who said that? Rock on. So, that valve is called, oddly enough, the ileocecal. cecal valve. What that does is that prevents the sterile stuff in the small intestines from getting into the large intestines where there's poop in there. Ooh. So watch. The large intestine's primary function in digestion is to absorb water and electrolytes. Tell me you got that. We know this. Also, if you look at the small intestines are hollow muscular tubes. The large intestines are larger than the small intestines. You should write that down, Toya. But they don't contract like the small intestines do. The small intestines go through peristaltic waves 20 to 30 times a day. The small intestines only go through peristaltic waves 2 to 3 times a day. So the band of muscle that goes down the middle, and then as you can see, this little band of muscle kind of projects fingers out here. This is what allows the segmentation of the large intestines to move that poop slowly through the large intestines. Do you got me? All right. And the large intestines is loaded with goblet cells. And again, the body does stuff that makes sense. The farther you move deeper into the large intestines, the more and more goblet cells are present. Because what are you absorbing back into the blood from the large intestines? Water. So that stool is now becoming more and more formed. So what you got to do is you got to lubricate that poop so it slides right down and then kerplunk right into the toilet. Say yeah. Got me? Now, just so you know, you have about 700 unique species of bacteria that are in your large intestines. It's called the normal flora or normal biota. They live a synergistic, symbiotic relationship with us. We give them a place to live. They help out us by digesting what's left of the food that was non-digested in the small intestines. They also make some vitamins that are difficult to come by. Vitamin K, which is involved in blood clotting. Niacin. Riboflavin. Right? We need these. And they will digest what's undigested in the small intestines. Now watch. Bacteria, do they say have the same metabolic machinery as we do? Toya, you're in microbiology. Help a brother out. You weren't even listening. Do they have the glycolysis and Krebs cycle? Say yes. Good. So these bacteria will use what's left over. Leftover carbs, fats, amino acids. If you don't digest them all, they're going to get into the large intestines. And the bacteria have all of that metabolic machinery. So they will break down glucose, fat, and amino acids. Say yeah. And what will they produce? They will produce gas. Carbon dioxide, methane, which if you ignite it, produces a blue flame. And from protein, hydrogen sulfide. That's why farts smell. And so deaf people can enjoy them. Don't you like that? That's funny. Tell me you got that. So they will digest what's undigested from the small intestine. That's watch. What's the definition of fiber? Poop? What's the definition of fiber? I try so hard. Guys, what's the definition of fiber? Why did they tell you to eat more fiber? Why does it add bulk? Ooh, not insoluble. It's not just, she did it. It's not digestible by the human body. We don't have the enzymes to digest it. So if you, this summer, you have like, because you're not going to read the textbook, right? You have a little family picnic, you eat some corn on the cob, and then a day or so later, you look and go, I don't remember eating that. It comes in the same way it goes out, whole. You got me? Why? Because you don't have the enzymes to break that down. So fiber, we can't digest it because we don't have the enzymes to break it up. And the more stuff that ends up in your large intestines, the large intestines have what's called a stretch-contract mechanism. The more stuff you have in the large intestines, the more frequently it will contract. That's why fiber makes you regular. Do you see that? Also, are there bacteria in there? Yeah. That's why fiber makes you gassy. Because we can't digest it, it ends up undigested in the large intestines. The bacteria can. That's why you get gassy with fiber. Say, yeah. You got that? All right. You better. What side did they tell you the person to lay on if you're going to give them an emina? Why? That why stuff. It's always that why stuff that kills you, huh? What do you mean? What was this? I saw that. Do you realize what a great example that was?
No, she said, say something, and I was like...
Oh, yeah, making stuff up now? Watch.
I already say enough.
If you put them on the left side, where does the sigmoid colon go? Rectum, left, sigmoid colon. So when you put them on the left side and you give them the enema, the higher the enema goes, the better the result. That's why you put them on your left side. Say yeah. All right. So as that's moving through the large intestines, you're absorbing the water and electrolytes. Say yeah. Cecum, ascending, transverse, descending, sigmoid, rectum. Rectum is like a little repository where you store and brew poop. You got me? As poop begins to fill the rectum has baroreceptors, and that will initiate the defecation reflex. You have an internal sphincter, which is under autonomic control. So once the rectum gets full, right, you're like, gotta go. And then you hold off, right, by squeezing the external sphincter, which is under conscious control. Wait till you get to the bathroom or yard, and then say, yeah. Can people who are paralyzed or, you know, below the waist or quadriplegic, can they poop on their own? How do you poop? You have to relax that external sphincter. You got me? Can they relax their external sphincter? So they have to be digitally stimulated. So you put them up in a chair if they're a quadriplegic, right? You put a glove on, hopefully. Put a little KY jelly. And you stick some suppositories up there that will irritate the rectum and it will cause it to contract. And then by stimulating the rectum, the sphincter, that will stimulate evacuation of the bowel. So they can't poop on their own. Tell me you got that.
Is there some truth to the squatty potty?
The squatty potty? What's the squatty potty? Do you know what a squatty potty is? All right, good. Oh, really?
So they make like a thing that you can actually like, squat for your toilet.
That's funny that it's called a stool. The squatty potty? You know what? Can I tell you? I wish I would have thought of some.
You have a celebratory movie.
You're kidding me. Yeah, you know what you want to do? Watch. I call this the second wave, right? You're handling your business, you think you're done, then you wipe your butt, and then you have to go again. Right, I call it the second wave. So anytime you stimulate the rectum, that will stimulate peristalsis and the evacuation of your bowel. So if you got to go, take care of business or get the squatty potty. The ducks? What are the ducks?
I mean, you really gotta go when you're trying to hit the baby. I can't make a good fart noise. It sounds like ducks.
Oh, ducks? Yeah. Oh, I get it.
Yeah.
Did I tell you about my buddy? He goes, called me up. This is years ago, before they had, like, phones and stuff. Tim, I took the best dump of my life. He goes, it was so good. I didn't want it to break, so I moved my butt on the bowl. And he took it someplace, like in a public bathroom, because he's got his hand there, the camera, and he's got his lighter, because he was afraid there wasn't going to be enough light. And it's like perfect in the bowl. Did I tell you about our little Saturday reviews? This is like 2 years ago. Right, so we do the Saturday review, and I'm like, hey, I got to go to the bathroom, right? So I go in, and I go into this handicap stall, because it gives you more room, you know? Anyways, there is a turd in there that looks like a Nerf football made out of Tootsie Rolls. I'm not even kidding. It was shaped just like a freaking Nerf, and it had big streaks of red blood on it. So there was one of two thoughts. Either that guy was proud of his achievement, or he was afraid that it was going to clog the toilet. That thing was, it was like, this is no joke, it was like that big around. That big around.
How do you get out?
Right. How do you get that out?
He took a baby.
Right. He took a baby turd. Oh, the barium?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he was like shooting softballs.
Oh, yeah.
For, like, days.
Yeah.
His
yeah. And then little kids too, they don't crap in public, right? They'll hold it like all day, right? And then get home, you know? They just don't do it. They need home field advantage. You need home field advantage. I was at O'Hare Airport, right? O'Hare. Got to go do it, right? Got a long flight. So I hear this guy giving himself a pep talk. Okay, you can do it. You can do it. Just take your time. Relax. All right, watch. I'm going to teach you something else. Where are the enzymes of the small intestine located? Please get this right. No, small intestine. Where are they located? Are they inside the cells that make up, that line the small intestines? They're embedded in the membrane. You got me? So watch. When you get diarrhea, those enzymes get washed away like every 3 days because those cells will peel off. So not only are you pooping out your, you know, Pizza Hut, but you're also pooping out the cells that make up your small intestines. You got me? Normally, the bacteria will digest those enzymes. But if you have diarrhea, those enzymes go through your large intestines and then get on the skin of your butt and digest the skin of your butt. That's why your butt gets red and raw when you have diarrhea. It's digesting your skin. So don't do that. Now watch. Ileostomy. That's where part of the small intestine comes out of the abdominal wall. Are there enzymes in that juice that is coming out? Mm-hmm. Yep. So that's why people who have ileostomy, they have nurses called ostomy nurses, where their job is to teach people who have ileostomies how to put that appliance bag on. Because if there is any space between that bag and that ileostium, or the ileostomy, that will leach out that juice and it will begin to digest the skin around it. Tell me you got that. That's funny. Pun is the lowest form of humor. Colostomy, just the opposite, right? It's a, right? Hole in your, where is it? Do you know when you're going to take a dump? I mean, to the second. Do people with a colostomy know? Yeah, they do. They give themselves an enema. So they take off the bag. They get a bag with some juice in the bathroom. They have a little comb, put a little KY in there, boom. Open it up, give themselves an enema, and then they evacuate. So if they're going to go on a trip or go out, they'll usually give themselves an enema so they don't have any accidents. The person with the ileostomy, they're the ones with the problems because that's 20, 30 times a day. That's why you always got to have that appliance on. And it's watery because where do you absorb water? In the large intestines. Say yeah. Got that? All right. That, ladies and gentlemen, is the complete digestion of a hangaburger. And it only took 2.5 hours. There you go. All right. I will leave it there. We did good today. A lot of good stuff. Oh, just before you hang up, which is worse? Bright red blood in your stool or dark tarry? Why? What's that?
The rupture happened in the system.
Why?
Because the blood has now turned brown. So
why? What? Not then you'd have big clots. What's hemoglobin? It's a protein. What's the cell membrane made out of? Fat. So when you start bleeding into your GI tract, if it's high, it will go through digestion. And when you digest a red blood cell, the hemoglobin is revealed, and you reveal the iron. And if you had a baby, anybody here have a baby? Right? They tell you to take iron supplements, and that turns your poop dark. So if you have dark tarry poop, that means you're bleeding higher in your GI tract. If it's bright red poop, it has not gone through digestion. Tell me you got, so they know it's lower in the GI tract. Say yeah. Do you see that?
What if you had
both? Well, then you're really messed up, and that's probably from not reading the textbook clearly. You know, many students who develop GI bleed of unknown origin from not reading the textbook. All right, so Thursday, it's the kidney quiz, yes? Okay. Yep, that's it, the last quiz you'll ever have in this class, and then the final, and I can't wait. It'll be all over, LaToya. Yep. Try it. Put some ice on it. You gotta take. You can take ibuprofen 3 times a day for 3 days. No. Just make sure you eat something. Come on. For what? About the kidney?